Welcome to this coronavirus Q&A with Senator Steve O'Bann. I'm your moderator, Tracy Ellis. With us are, of course, Senator Steve O'Bann and Scott E. Michael from the Employment Security Department. Senator O'Bann represents the 28th Legislative District. He serves on the Health and Long-Term Care, Transportation, and Behavioral Health Committees. He was a small business owner providing living wage jobs and takes a special interest in veterans, mental health, and healthcare issues. Mr. Michael is the Legal Services Coordination Manager of Employment System Policy at the Employment Security Department. We encourage you to ask questions during this forum. There are three ways to do that. You can use the Zoom group chat box or the comment section with this Facebook Live video. You can also email me, tracy.ellis@leg.wa.gov. That's tracy.ellis@leg.wa.gov. Again, thank you for being with us for this special event. Let's start with an opening statement from Senator O'Bann.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you for joining me. A few comments first before we do take your questions. So COVID-19 and the response to it have put under enormous strain our families and our employment, our small businesses, and certainly our healthcare system. And I've had a chance to field many of your questions and the questions of your neighbors over the last several weeks. And so I thought it was the right time to do a town hall like this to take more of your questions that I'm sure you have about the current situation and how the government is dealing with it, and when we might be hoping to reopen our economy in a safe and phased way. First and foremost, this is a health crisis. No one should doubt that. And if you've lost a loved one or have a family member suffering from COVID-19, our hearts and prayers go out to you and to your family. And if you're a frontline healthcare worker or first responder, or maybe you work in a shelter for the homeless, I want to thank you for your service to our community. Really, you are the best of us, and we're proud of you and grateful for the sacrifice you and your families are making for us. The first priority, obviously, has been trying to protect the public health, especially the vulnerable. And I happen to work on a team right now where we're trying to find appropriate quarantine space for some of the most vulnerable in our population with mental health illness and are COVID-19 positive and need a safe place to be cared for away from the general population so they don't infect others. There are many that are working on this issue in a variety of ways. We have reason for hope. I want to emphasize that. The state efforts to flatten the infection and the fatality curves are paying off. They're flattening. There were 33 new cases as of the 21st, a few days ago, and that's down from a peak of 432 cases at the end of March on the 23rd. As to fatality, same thing. We're seeing the trend go down, which is, of course, the most important rate that we're looking at. Hospital stays in Pierce County, the peak was 71, and we're down to 28 in Pierce County. So very good news. The governor's stay-at-home order for all but essential activities are hitting many of employees and their employers hard. And I want to be able to answer the questions that you may have today about unemployment benefits and maybe other state and federal assistance that's provided for small businesses. I'm grateful to have here Scott Michael. Scott works with the Employment Security Department and knows a lot more than me, about unemployment benefits. And he's here to ask or answer some of your questions. Some of you may have questions about the length and the extent of the governor's stay-at-home order. If you do, I'll try to answer. But please keep in mind, under our system of government, that the governor has the exclusive authority, as in most states, in emergencies like this, to act to protect the public health and safety. He ultimately decides when and how to relax the stay-at-home order. And I genuinely believe that he is doing what he believes is best for the health and safety of our state. Finally, before we open it up for questions, and we'll start with some that have already been submitted, I want to give you an update on some of the written requests I've made of the governor recently. One was to ask that he suspend the collection of the car tab taxes, while so many of our neighbors have lost their jobs and can't frankly afford to pay them. I've also got a request into the governor to permit residential construction on the same terms that he is permitting construction on public projects. And then I also had a letter in asking for the governor to make it clear that houses of worship are essential and that they should be able to continue to live stream in a safe manner. We're still waiting for written responses from the governor, but he has indicated verbally that he intends to slowly open residential construction in the near future. So we're very much waiting to hear his plans that will be forthcoming on that front. And he has also said verbally that houses of worship may streamline their services. So a little bit of an update on those important issues that we've requested more clarification from him on. All right, let me start with some questions that have been submitted already to us. And I'm gonna put those to you, Scott. They're unemployment related questions that I think probably a lot of our audience would also want answers to. So the first one, Scott, is how long should I expect to wait for my first check, my first unemployment benefit check, after filling out my unemployed insurance claim and getting approval?
So that's a very good question. As a general rule, I'm going to give you the four best tips for anybody filing for unemployment, whether it's a regular state claim or one of the new federal claims that is available to individuals under the new CARES Act, the program that we launched over the weekend, this past weekend. The first thing to advise everybody is to carefully study our website, esd.wa.gov/unemployment. There you will see all sorts of tips and tricks, checklists. You can also sign up for a webinar where you can have somebody tell you how, walk you through the process, give you the secrets on, or not necessarily the secrets, but tips on how to avoid any sort of trip ups or snafus with your application that will delay your check getting processed. Second big tip I want to give everyone is that on our website, we do have a list of documents we suggest everyone have handy before they start filing their applications. And so we heavily encourage people to get those documents together because you're probably going to need them. And if you have to delay, you may get timed out. So just have a read our website, figure out what's coming, get your documents together before you apply. Other thing, please use our online e-services. While it did get slow over this past weekend as a result of everyone trying to access the new federal benefits, it is up and running. And if you ever find any slow spots, encourage folks to try some off hours, such as super late at night or early in the morning. And then finally, use direct deposit. Just like you would with your employer, you obviously get deposit as opposed to having to wait for us to mail you a prepaid debit card and then load it with benefits. So if you can do all of those things, some people have been seeing approved claims paid out within 24 to 48 hours.
Okay. What is the most common question that you get, Scott, and what is the best answer for that question?
the most common question I've been getting in my role here is, what's with all the delays, and what's that going to do to my benefit check? And so one is that I understand that there have been bunches of delays. Folks are frustrated getting into the phone lines. Those have been overloaded. Folks have been frustrated trying to get answers when they send us messages online. We get it. We understand. We're working on it, and we sympathize, and we're sorry. You know, a little over a month ago, we had 7,000 people file a claim in a week. Shortly after the governor started issuing emergency orders, that shifted to tens of thousands of claims a day. So we are escalating as quickly as we can to address to that impact for something that, you know, nobody 6, 7, 8 weeks ago could have foreseen how much of an impact that we are seeing right now. So we're doing a little bit of catch up, but ultimately, what is this going to do to your benefits? Once we are able to approve your benefits, we are paying those retroactive to the date you are eligible. You are not going to be penalized for any delays on our part as far as being able to access the phone, access online, get information. If we can approve your claim, we will approve it back to the date you're eligible with full pay. That includes the $600 that's going to be added onto everybody's unemployment check as a result of the new CARES Act that goes back to the end of April. So folks who have approved claims and have been claiming since April, you're going to be seeing a much bigger check this week than you have in previous weeks.
Okay, and that goes to my next question or questions that I've been getting from constituents, and that is, when can I expect my state claim after I've been approved? And when can I expect the federal supplement, the $600 you just mentioned? And do I need to do anything to make sure I get that $600 a week?
So for that $600 a week, the only thing that you need to do is you need to file your weekly claim. And as long as we are able to pay you $1 in underlying benefits, we're going to top that off with an extra $600. So we could pay you as little as a dollar, or under our current standards, up to $890. As long as you fall within the $1 to $890 range, we're going to top it off with an extra flat $600. And that's going to be retroactive for all weeks that you have claimed and are eligible to claim back to the beginning of April.
Okay, great. I'm sure that's encouraging to many. Okay. All right. Here's a question that I've been getting, and let me ask it or ask the question and do my best to answer it. And then maybe we can take questions that have started to come in. What should be done to reduce the risk of COVID transmission while the state reopens? So we obviously have a huge healthcare issue. We want to be safe. We want to protect the public from any additional transmission, but we also know we need to start opening up our economy. So the answer, I think, is, and the governor and other healthcare officials have started to kind of lay out that plan, and that is that each business needs to work out safe distancing and cleaning protocols, probably appoint somebody in their workplace to make sure those are all followed. And then we need to make testing available to anyone who has symptoms or believe that they've been exposed. I'm working right now with a group here in Pierce County to come up with antibody testing, which is going to be crucial in determining the prevalence of the coronavirus. I think that and the testing we're doing now, assuming we can scale it up, are going to be crucial in that whole reopening effort. So it's a combination of starting to open up our job sites, our employment settings, but do so in a safe manner and make sure that we can still achieve social distancing, testing in a more robust, broad way than we have up to this point. And I think that's the way we get our economy open. And I'm anxious to see that happen very, very soon. And so that's the answer to that in broad strokes. Also, I've been getting questions about the governor's order, probably the relationship between the governor and the legislature. So the governor, like so many other governors around the country, they have very broad unilateral power in a case of emergency such as this to issue orders to protect the safety and health of the public. The legislature does not, we're not in session. We don't have a chance to weigh in as a body on anything the governor is doing. With a few exceptions, there are some waiver of rules that the governor has required the legislature to periodically agree to extend or not. It doesn't apply to the stay-at-home order. That the legislature can't weigh in on that. That's fully the governor's power. But we, for example, have extended the part of the order that said that you can't visit nursing homes, or visitors can't visit nursing homes that may be, you know, specially open and vulnerable to infection. So that would just be one example of an order that we as a legislature have approved the extension of. Okay, let me turn it over to, I guess, Tracy. You've been getting some questions from those who are watching. Why don't you put a question to either Scott or to myself?
Sure. There are several related, they're kind of connected, related to unemployment. For example, Leslie's brother applied for unemployment and was denied because he was part-time, but he met all the criteria for approval. His coworker was approved. Both men were hired together, same day, have identical work schedules. One gets unemployment, the other doesn't. Any reason why that might be, Scott?
It's tough to know without looking at any particular case why any one person was denied versus another. And the unemployment system and the unemployment criteria are nuanced enough that there may be reasons that aren't immediately perceptible. And sometimes it could just be that there is an error made in filling out a form that caused it to go into a queue where it needed additional investigation. So it's really hard to speculate without knowing more details, getting that person on the phone, pulling up their claim in the computer. So I encourage everyone to be patient with us as we build capacity. But one of the things that I am excited to announce is that last week we had 500 people on the phone. This week we are doubling that to 1,000. Also, one of the things that was delaying folks getting answers on the phone was that over the majority of people who are calling our phone lines didn't have any particular issues, problems with their claim. They just wanted general unemployment information that was, and so we were happy to give out those answers, but it was delaying time for our claims agents to help process claims and get people moving that may be hung up in the process. So one of the things that we did is we launched a questions only number. So if you just have general unemployment questions about what you may or may not be eligible for, as opposed to anything tied to your specific claim, we encourage you to call 833-572-8400, 833-572-8400. So by diverting as many questions over to that other phone number as possible, we're again freeing up claims agents to help run these claims through. So again, I sympathize. It's a Byzantine system, even during normal times and during abnormal times. I apologize. We sympathize. We're working through it, and we'll get through this together. And remember, we will backdate you to the date you're eligible and get you those benefits.
Let me interject here, Tracy. If you have specific questions about your claim, your benefits, in a few minutes, we're going to give you my phone number, my office phone number, and email. Please send us your specific questions and problems you're having, and we will follow up with them, probably with Scott or someone else, to help us actually, adjudicate and get you answers to your specific claim that Scott obviously is not going to be able to do right here and now. Tracy?
Yeah, I guess maybe instead of just focusing on specific claims, we do have a couple of questions related to part-time employment and also a question about being furloughed. I mean, obviously, these are different circumstances than normal unemployment. Anything you could tell people who have been furloughed or who are part-time workers?
So for folks who are working part-time, one is I hope that your employer has has you on our shared work program. So what a shared work program is that instead of employers laying their employees off completely, It allows them to basically reduce their hours to part-time, so between 10 to 50%. And then unemployment will come in and make up the difference with a commensurate amount of unemployment benefits. So if we reduce them to from full-time to half-time, we'll pay them half of what they would normally get in an unemployment check. So employees actually end up with more money in their bank account than if they were just completely laid off and receiving their full unemployment check. The other benefit to the employers who do this is that they won't be charged for the unemployment benefits that are being paid. So they won't see an increase in their tax rate. So we hope that folks who are working part-time are on our shared work program. Generally, folks who are working part-time, if they're not on shared work, the wages that they receive will be deducted from their unemployment benefits. So if you've worked enough hours, or if you have enough, or if you're getting like half of the week in paid leave, that may end up reducing the amount of your unemployment benefit to zero. And there is a second part of that question that I think I lost my mental train on.
That's okay. Furlough, for people who have been furloughed, what are their options?
So people who have been furloughed, I understand that to mean just completely laid off. They can be, they are placed on what's called standby. And what standby integrates, hopefully, as the governor is able to reopen the economy, your employer will be able to ramp up their business and bring you back on as a full-time employee or part-time employee, depending on where you were when you when this whole thing started. Work search. All you have to do is just stay in contact with your employer, and when they're able to take you back, be able to go back and join them and go back to work as soon as you can, which is what I think almost everyone in this scenario wants to do. They want to go back to work, and that's all you got to do. And so for those who are on furlough, we are getting everyone on standby now. Folks in the earlier processes may have received letters saying that you have been denied standby. Do not worry about those letters. And even if you are denied, because if you're denied standby, it doesn't mean that you're denied a claim. It just means that we're going to require you to look for work. But even the governor has waived work search requirements. So nobody right now is required to look for work. Everybody's on standby. As soon as we can get the economy open, we're gonna maybe start requiring people to start looking for work as soon as the economy is open. But for now, everyone's on standby. No one has to look for work. So being on furlough is going to work out for folks just the same as folks who are completely laid.
For you, Senator O'Ban. James says, it seems unfair that we've closed businesses, we've laid off a third of the people in our state, and some of the people can't even pay rent right now. But state employees are still drawing full pay. Why isn't their pay being cut?
Well, to the first part of the question, I don't remember in my lifetime impact this has had economically on so many people. Folks who are, gainfully employed suddenly now are home and wondering if they're going to be able to make their family budgets, next week. It's tragic. And there's, unemployment and some federal assistance, but it's slow in coming. And even when it does, it's not the same thing as having a good paying job. So it's frustrating, and I want this over as soon as possible. I hear you. As far as state employees are concerned, I expect very soon we'll get a forecast. Well, I guess it'll come out in June of the drop in revenue to the state, and I would expect the legislature will meet in special session shortly after that. And that's when we will have to take up this great channel. Sorry, Scott, for you to hear this as a state employee, but we'll have to take a look at the drop in revenues and what that means to the state budget and cuts that are most certainly going to be made. Will it mean a cut in pay and layoffs or furloughs? As I understand that happened, the Great Recession, I was not in the legislature and government then, but I would expect each agency is going to be called on by the governor to start making some reductions because the revenues are certainly going to be significantly down. And so I would expect that James will see the public sector also follow suit. And if, you know, and if someone's in a non-essential area in government, I would expect that to happen as well for them. And I don't know if the governor considers any sector of the state government to be non-essential. It's a good question and something I'll look into, but that's his call to make.
Scott, this one is for you. Tim's boss is harassing him to return to work as a nail tech on May 4th, even though nail salons are not considered essential businesses. He says it would be difficult to maintain social distancing, but he's worrying that his boss might fire him. He's wondering how he should respond, and can his boss fire him?
So whether or not your boss can or cannot fire you is something that I'm not equipped to say. I'm not an employment lawyer, and I wouldn't advise you to take my advice. I would consult Tim's own attorney on that. As far as what it will, its impact to his potential unemployment claim, we did do some emergency rules over the past couple weeks that does say that if somebody is an essential employee, yet is nonetheless working in an area that is not following accepted guidelines, such as from the Department of Labor and Industries, that they can be deemed laid off for lack of work and potentially eligible for unemployment benefits. For non-essential employees, we have also deemed them to be laid off for a lack of work. Now that's tied to the governor's stay-at-home order. So if that gets lifted on May 4th, which it may or may not be, that's up to him. And I'm not in his back pocket. I'm not on his speed dial by any stretch of the imagination. So it basically comes down to for folks who quit, you have to have, under normal circumstances, you have to have good cause to quit, which could include changes in workplace safety or violations of law. So if something illegal is happening at the workplace, you bring it up with your employer and they still don't change it, you may have good cause to quit. For some people who are discharged, meaning that the employer fired them, they can be allowed benefits so long as they didn't engage in misconduct. And that's gonna be, and that's a pretty deep topic. So I wish Tim all the best. I hope that he and his employer can work something out collaboratively and come to some sort of agreement in order to, I think, ease both of their concerns heading into the economy starting to open back up.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to quickly give out Senator Oban's contact information. You can always email him at steve.oban@leg.wa.gov. That's steve.oban@leg.wa.gov. Or you can call his office, 360-786-7654, 360-786-7654. And we'll give that email and also the phone number out again a little bit later on. Remember, you can ask questions today. It's very easy to do so. You can just comment on the Facebook live video and that's happening right now. You can use your Zoom chat box to ask a question, or you can email me. And my email is tracy.ellis@leg.wa.gov. And back to the questions now. Jeannie doesn't like the way the media is reporting about the virus. And she's wondering, is there a better way to get the information out. I suppose what we're doing right now would be one example.
I'll take that question. There are, I guess it depends too on the nature of information that she's looking for. There's so many helpful websites about the prevalence of the virus and healthcare issues. We've talked about some of the information available for employment security. You know, if it's a question about the governor's order, for example, feel free to reach out to me if she has a specific question about that or any other issue she doesn't think is getting answered by what she's getting in the media.
Brad feels like we've lost sight of our lockdown intent. He says it was never to get rid of the virus, but to slow the spread and to not overwhelm our healthcare system. He says, since that's basically been achieved, why is testing now a top priority for startup? You know, that's not going to get rid of the virus. Why not just start things up, start things up now?
Well, I know the governor is concerned that if the economy were to start up immediately, you know, the light switch on metaphor that he has often used rather than dialing it in a gradual way back up, that we may see infection rates spring back up. And then we're dealing with the same factors that led him to make the decision that he did. I think, in my view, it's time now to be looking at these so-called non-essential business sectors and asking whether we can open those up in a safe manner. That's the way I think we should be looking at it now, given the fact that these curves have been flattened so much, not immediately reopening the economy, certainly, but starting to look at different sectors. And I'll take an example that has certainly caught our attention, rightly so, and that's the residential commercial construction area. There's a protocols developed now for safe distancing that would allow that industry to be reopened. I think it should be reopened, provided those protocols are followed, and I think they can be in most construction work sites. I mean, we have public construction projects that are allowed and have never been stopped. I think if the same protocols used there can be followed in the private sector, the private construction, then they should be opened up too. So I think we should be asking, can we do this in a safe manner with social distancing and other safety protections? And if so, we should open up that area.
And actually that brings us to another question. Mike wants to know why commercial real estate is not an essential industry.
Well, once again, if the question is about construction, I think that's in the same category as residential construction. I think commercial and residential should be treated the same. If those can be done, and I think they can, in a safe manner, then they should be opened up. And we certainly have seen that with the Key Arena project, with other big so-called public construction. If those can be done in a safe manner, then they certainly, the other sector should be opened up as well.
Rose wants to know about recreation. She says it seems like reopening state parks for use by individuals and small family groups would be beneficial. When will state parks be allowed to reopen? And might I add, as a golfer, what about golf courses?
A lot of attention on golf courses. Well, again, I'm not the governor, so I can only give my own views. Ultimately, this is a decision of the governor, and he's relying on information I may not readily possess. But I know that near where I live, folks come out and they take walks, and they do it largely in a socially responsible manner. I know when my wife and I go out for a walk, we are careful to distance ourselves from others. I should think that's possible too in a park-like setting. I do remember early on that parks were open, and then there were some photographs of individuals who were not practicing social distancing. So I think that led to the closure of our state and local parks My hunch is people have the message now. They understand how important it is to socially distance, maybe to wear masks in some situations. So my hunch is people would be a lot more careful now than maybe they were early on some weeks ago. So I know the governor did mention in his last press conference that he was seriously considering opening up certain outdoor recreational activities. I hope that also will include our parks, and we can, you know, we can see, we'll monitor that. If people do it in a socially responsible manner, distancing manner, then we can keep those parks open. If they don't, then he could make a different decision at that point.
Obviously, public health is going to need to be funded during this time. Do you have a plan to better fund public health? And Steve suggests maybe you could use the car tab money.
Well, that's interesting. Well, those are really different revenue streams. As far as public health, I think we've certainly seen how crucial it is that we have a well-funded, ready-to-go public health system, which is, in this case, is really being done at the local level. It's the local public health departments that are doing the major lifting in trying to eradicate this disease and deal with all of the public health fallout from it. I certainly will support greater funding. I think you'll have a renewed interest in making sure public health is adequately funded.
Any ideas about the return of elective surgery? This person's interested in cataract surgery, but elective surgery in general, he says, I would think eye surgery, for example, is essential when your eyesight is degrading rapidly. What about elective surgery?
Absolutely. And I think that's a misnomer. Elective makes it sound like it's something that you could easily forgo and it doesn't have a health impact. I think there have been some healthcare procedures that have been allowed to be delayed that shouldn't have. I was heartened to see the governor mention that he is also looking at lifting his order with respect to the surgical procedures that have been prevented. And remember, the reason for that largely, and it wasn't just our governor, but the president and nationally, there was the concern we wouldn't have enough hospital space, because if we had a surge problem and we needed those hospital rooms and those ICUs for COVID-19 positive patients that were in serious distress, we wanted to make sure we had capacity. The other thing was the PPE, the personal protection equipment. We have had a shortage. We continue to not have enough of that PPE, that personal protection equipment. So that was another reason to try to reduce the use of hospital capacity for so-called elective procedures. We were encouraged to see that there's enough space in hospitals to do some of these surgeries. We just have to make sure there's enough of that PPE so that we can use that when it comes to dealing with COVID-19 positive patients.
I have a question here about essential services. This person's wondering who decides what services are essential, and it seems to vary state by state.
Well, once again, that's ultimately the governor's decision. There was a national list of essential services that I think has been a framework for other states, but ultimately it's the governors of each state that decides whether they will follow that national list of essential services or not. California and Oregon came up with their own list that was very similar to the national list. And in fact, they permitted commercial and real estate construction. And I think that was consistent with the federal list of essential services. So there are patterns out there for governors to use and decide how they want to apply it to their given states. In this case, though, it was the governor and his staff and advisors that made the decision as to what was essential and what was not.
Tom says safe doesn't mean risk-free. We're going to have to find a way to mitigate risk, not completely eliminate it. And he wonders, is anyone tracking the increase in suicides, domestic violence, and child abuse as a result of the lockdown?
That is a great question. And the focus has so much been on trying to bend or flatten that fatality and infection curves. But we can't lose sight of the issues that the questioner is raising. I work as a senator and in my other job on behavioral health related issues, and we're already seeing that significant increase in behavioral health related issues. Those are individuals with mental health, depression, and other disorders that are under a tremendous amount of stress, and it's aggravated by the isolation of the stay-at-home order, as you can imagine. We're also seeing an increase in drug use. And as people probably, unfortunately kind of medicate some of their emotional psychological issues, we are seeing that increase, unfortunately. And I have a sneaking suspicion that will not go away anytime soon. So that has been a strain, particularly on our mental health and substance use disorder recovery systems, to provide for those individuals that have that are under greater strain in that way. And at the same time that we have staff that are out sick or self-quarantining or have to be home because their children are home, so that we have a staffing shortage in the healthcare field as well. There are so many unintended consequences of this disease and the government reaction to it. It's time now, I think, to be looking at ways that we can begin to reopen our economy in a safe manner so that we get people back to work and able to provide for their families and deal with this added stress that being forced to be home and away from one's social network and not having a job has created for our communities.
So Dean, he actually listed, I'm sure you don't have the revised code of Washington in front of you. He actually listed the code, the section and subsection, but it basically comes down to this. He says the way he reads that, it's not permitted to have these restrictions in place beyond 30 days because it interferes with the freedom of assembly. Can you shed any light on that?
Well, there are, I alluded to it earlier, there are certain orders that the governor has made that are subject every 30 days to legislative review. And I've actually been in those discussions about whether we're going to extend for another 30 days a particular aspect of the governor's order. And I mentioned one that he had an order that prohibited individuals from going into long-term care facilities, because that's obviously a very vulnerable population. That's where a lot of our fatalities and serious COVID-19 related illnesses have taken place. So the legislature agreed to continue that particular order. What we don't have any check and balance over or any ability to weigh in is on the stay at home or stay home, stay healthy order of the governor's. That is his decision to make, and it's up to him to decide whether he's going to extend it or not beyond May 4th. It does appear from some of the comments that the governor has made that he intends to extend the stay home, stay healthy order beyond May 4th, but may make some adjustments, like in the case of in a phased way, opening up again residential and commercial construction, opening up outdoor recreations of some kind, and also of allowing so-called elective surgeries that are presently prohibited.
Here's one, Scott, that you might be able to help out with. Why is the state requiring self-employed individuals to apply and then be denied the employee benefit before they can apply for the special self-employment benefit? So they apply, they're denied, then they have to reapply, I think is what they're asking, for self-employed people.
The simple answer is Congress. So these federal benefits are federal, meaning that the federal government is paying for them. They come out of the federal treasury. And we also do not charge state employers for those benefits. So employers don't get charged for them. They don't come out of the trust fund. So there's more money left in the trust fund to pay regular unemployment benefits. But before Congress is willing to dish out its federal money, it wants to make absolutely certain that there isn't, that these folks can't be covered under state benefits. So under guidance that we've received from the United States Department of Labor, based on their reading of the CARES Act and what was written into the CARES Act, we have to, in order to pay out this federal money, require individuals to apply for a state claim, get denied, and then once they have that denial in hand, then they can apply for the federal benefits. Does it sound bureaucratic and messy? Yes, it is. I get it. We hate it too. But that is the hoops that we have to jump through. Because this is federal money, the feds get to call the shots. And so we have to jump through the same hoops that they require us to do as well.
This question, and I hear a lot of people talk about this, Senator, Lisa wonders, is the governor's power absolute? I guess, is there a time when the legislature can overturn what he rules? Or maybe just talk a little bit about the separations and what the governor's power is.
Sure. So the legislature, you know, previously to this whole COVID-19 thing, gave the authority to the governor to make emergency orders in the case of a national or state disaster, such as the one we're living under right now. And the reason for that is that you need someone who can react to the conditions and circumstances of that disaster. You leave that up to the legislature, you know, of 49 senators and 98 House members, and it can't possibly be flexible enough to deal with a crisis. So, and that's not, we're not alone. That's virtually what every other state does. They empower the governor to make those critical decisions in a crisis. So that just shows how important that office is. Who we elect to that office, they have good judgment and take good counsel and make good tough decisions. And this has been a very difficult and highly stressed situation. And the governor, you know, is I think doing his best. I certainly, though, having lived through this for the first time as a elected leader, I want to make some adjustments to the statutory authority that we have given the governor. I think it would be in his interest if the legislature could periodically, every 30 days, for example, weigh in on some of these decisions. I think that would be helpful to the process. So that's certainly something I know I and others will want to take a look at when we get back in session. I expect to have a special session probably by June to take up mainly the budgetary impacts of COVID-19, the shutdown order. The one check and balance that does exist right now are the courts. So if a governor should violate the Constitution, somebody mentioned the right of assembly or religious freedom or free speech, that's where we make sure those basic civil rights are protected are in our courts. And I'm aware of lawsuits in other states, and I don't know the status or nature of those claims, but that is, the Constitution is the ultimate check and balance on the governor and on the legislature if it goes beyond the constitutional limitations of those two branches of government. So that's our nature of our system. And it just shows you how important the executive branch is. It shows you how important the judicial branch is when we're in a situation like this. I hope I've done my best to answer that question, but those are essentially the division of power between our three branches.
Well, it's interesting. We often hear, and Mario brings this up, we all often hear about the four corners. And I, you know, for us who are in the business, you know, we all know what that means. And the four corners have to approve this or that. And I guess maybe explain what that means a little bit. And he also wonders, you know, what's the likelihood that the House minority and Senate minority leaders will extend the stay-at-home order as is, or is that even possible?
So again, the legislature, the four corners, and I'll define that in just a second. We have no authority to weigh in on the stay-at-home order. That is, in the way that the law was set up, that is his sole discretion. So as far as what is the four corners, yeah, that's a buzzword we use. Essentially, it applies to, we have two chambers, the House and the Senate, and within each of those bodies, you have the minority party and the majority party. And so we're saying the four corners are the two parties in each of those chambers. So that's where we get to four corners. So it's those four corners of the leadership of each of those bodies that will that are allowed to, under our statutory scheme here, to decide whether to extend or not certain of the governor's orders, and not, again, not the stay-at-home order. We don't have authority to weigh in on that one and continue it or refuse to continue it 30 days. But that, hopefully I've explained what the four corners is and how it applies in this situation.
And unfortunately, that's going to do it. That's all the time we have. If you weren't able to get your question answered, or you'd like to contact Senator Oban's office on any other issue, feel free to email steve.oban@leg.wa.gov. That's steve.oban@leg.wa.gov, or call 360-786-7654. That's 360-786-7654. And Senator Oban, would you like to make a closing statement?
Sure. I want to, again, thank Scott, Michael, for joining us. He obviously is very knowledgeable on these employment issues. And I want to thank him for taking the time to be with us today. And again, if you have questions that were not answered this afternoon, please, please contact my office. That's what I'm here for, is to help try to answer questions that you have during this extraordinary time when so many of our lives have been turned upside down. So please contact my office. We'll do the best we can to answer them. And maybe we'll ask Scott to help us with specific questions that we may have. He didn't sign up for that, but we may be reaching out to him to help us with specific questions of those who are in the audience. Again, I wanted this opportunity to talk with as many of you who could join us, to express my absolute understanding of the challenges that many of you are under. I'm dealing with COVID-related issues and the ramifications of it all day long in my other work for the county. And I want to encourage you, this is an opportunity for all of us to come together as a community and help one another. I've heard so many wonderful stories too about folks who are helping their neighbors, helping seniors who are shut in or shouldn't be going out because they're in that vulnerable population, and folks are buying groceries or helping them out. One great story I like to relate is a gal who was buying groceries for several elderly couples. She went to the grocery store, had purchased all the items, was there in the checkout line, and like I've done this, forgot her purse and was not able to buy all these items. And so she was going to have to go home, come back. And the grocery store clerk said, "Hey, we'll take care of it." So the grocery store picked up the entire tab. That's deeply encouraging to me that I'm in a community that has folks like that want to help each other. And so that's why I want to be as a resource to you, to help you help with issues you're facing and ones that I can answer or help with as your state senator. So again, contact my office if we can help you in any way. And I will continue to express my beliefs to the governor on changes that should be made to the stay-at-home order. He I'm waiting for some responses. I hope we'll get those soon. There is a way, if you want to see clarification or wish the governor to change the decisions he's made, there's a website to go to, and we can provide that later through the Department of Commerce. But we want to be a resource to you. You're the people I represent. I want to help you as much as I can. So please, again, reach out. Thank you for taking the time to listen in. And it's if we think there's a need, we may do another one of these in the near future. So thank you for being with us.